Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
So Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for your goodness. We thank you for your blessing. I thank you, Lord, for the honor of coming to this wonderful, fabulous church. And thank you for allowing me to speak to your people. And Lord, we don't come to hear from a man, we come to hear from the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, have your way. Teach us, lead us, guide us, and direct us in all that the Father would have us to know so that we could be what the Father has called us to be. And not only us, Lord, we lift up all the churches in Riverside, the Inland Empire, all around the world, God. We ask in Jesus' name, you bless all those that are preaching the gospel. In no way do we consider ourselves better than anyone else, but we are all co-laborers in your kingdom, building the kingdom of God. And Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your blessing tonight. Let us have ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord wants to say to us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Tonight I've entitled this message, Extreme Faith. The Bible says without faith it is impossible to please God. Amen? For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. We got to have faith. Jesus said, the Word of God says, that the just shall live by faith. When he said the just shall live by faith, he wasn't talking about, it wasn't just saying, come on, if they can, if they try, or they should. He's saying, my people will live by faith. See, God will never put you in a comfortable place in your life. He's always going to challenge you because he wants his people to live by faith at all times. And that's the God we serve. Amen. You know, I was a while back, you know, I don't know if they have it now, but how many have ever been to McDonald's where they had the $1 drinks? Come on, y'all know you've been saying, I shouldn't have drank all those $1 drinks. You know, I had too many of them. You know, $1, any size. You know, you go into McDonald's and it's any size for $1. And, you know, you go in there and, you know, most people, they're not going to get the small drink for a dollar. I mean, you know, you walk in, what are you going to do? You're going to get the big, come on, man, I'm Hispanic, man. Give me it all for a dollar. I want it all, man. I'll just take it. Give me more, amen. $1, I can have anything. I can have the largest one, the small. I'm taking the biggest one. Isn't that right? You see people go in and pay a dollar to get a medium. You think, what's wrong with that person? You know, you can get the big one. My friend Mario's here. I remember one time we went to a drive-thru, and he goes to the drive-thru, and he says, let me have a little one. And the lady says, a small? He goes, no, make it a big one. She goes, large? He goes, no, a little big one. He remembers that too. Amen. But you know, you go in McDonald's, and it's $1. You can get any size. You know, I thought to myself, that's exactly the way the kingdom of God is. See, your Christian life and my Christian life, I can live my life and with small for Jesus. I can live medium for Jesus. Come on now. I can live large because the price was paid the same. Amen. The same price was paid, but it's my choice if I want to live small, if I want to live medium, or if I want to live large. It's the same. The same price was paid. You know, I always look at that and say, you know what? I don't want to live small for Jesus. I want to live big for Jesus. I don't want to live medium for Jesus. I don't even want to live large for Jesus. I want to be supersized for Jesus. Amen? Look at your neighbor and say, get supersized for Jesus. You know, in the Bible, in John, open your Bible with me to John chapter 11. We came to hear the Bible, didn't we? John chapter 11, verse 17, we're going to talk about extreme faith. And it is a time when Lazarus had died and was in the tomb, and Mary and Martha are really having a hard time. And they call for Jesus, you know, and Jesus kind of takes a little time. He doesn't show up right away. And he finally shows up. And we pick up the story in verse 17. It says, So when Jesus came, he found that he had already been dead in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. This is John chapter 11, verse 17 through 28. Now Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, Lord, I know that whatever you ask of God, he will give you." So she comes to Jesus and she says to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would be alive. He would not have been dead. You'd raise him up." And Jesus says to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection and the last day." You see, Martha believed God that Jesus was able to raise her brother. But if you notice, she says to Jesus, "If you had been here, he would have risen. If you had been here." See, what happens many times is we don't have a problem believing the miracles of the past. We have faith for the past. You know, I looked at the Word of God in Hebrews chapter 11, 1. It says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for." Speaking of faith today, I guess we should read that scripture. "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen." And I noticed that it starts with the word "now." Because yesterday's faith is not good enough. You need a now faith. Amen. Come on now. It says now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Not yesterday's faith. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. You need God to do something now in your life. Not yesterday. Amen. See, God is looking for a now faith. I love the word faith. In our church, we have a phrase I always say. This is a simple definition of faith. You got to see it before you see it, if you want to see it. As simple as that. Faith is you got to see it before you see it, if you want to see it. And Jesus says to Martha, he says, "I am the resurrection and the life. And he who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this? See, Martha shows up and he says, "Your brother will rise." And Martha says, "I know he will rise in the resurrection day. I know he'll rise in the resurrection in the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this? And I love what it says in verse 27. And she said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God who has come into the world." In other words, she dodged the question. He didn't ask her, "Do you believe I'm the Messiah?" He said, "Do you believe that though he is dead, he will rise?" She goes, "Yes, Lord, I believe you're the Messiah." Looks like she dodged the question there. And then in verse 28, it says, "And when she had said these things, she went her way secretly, called Mary her sister, saying, the teacher has come and is calling for you." Jesus never asked for Mary. Nowhere in the Bible does Jesus say, "Go get Mary, I need her." Did you hear that? I didn't hear that. No. See, what Martha did is she had a hard time believing. See, she believed up here because she says, "Even now, Lord, I know you'll do it." But see, she had a different type of thinking. Because see, she had faith up here. See, you can have a faith up here. You can know that God is able to do it. But that faith up here needs to resonate down here. You have the idea of God being able to do something in your life, in your circumstance, in your situation, but do you have a faith to believe that, come on, you can know it, or do you know it? So what did Martha do? She ran and got Mary. I believe she ran and got Mary to see if Mary had enough faith. See, because how many know, it's much easier to believe for someone else's problem. You know what I'm talking about, right? Someone else comes and they have a problem. And they come and say, "Oh, brother or sister, will you pray for me?" And oh man, we get all Pentecostal. Shando, brother, I pray for you. We lay hands on them. Oh, in the name of, we even get really out there. I mean, come on, in the name of Jesus. You know, and we can believe God for someone else's problem. How many know what I'm talking about? Come on, help me now. It's easy to believe for somebody else's problem, but oh, come on now. All of a sudden it becomes your problem. It's like, what? And I mean, you were a woman, man of faith and power when it was someone else's issue, but now it's your problem. And man, it's all, see, we can have faith up here and not have faith down here. God's looking for a people that have a now faith. Amen? A now faith. And so here's Martha, and she is just totally having a hard time. I remember one, we got our new building, and as we had this new building, man, you know, we had some things that were taken care of, and we kind of got in, you know. Pastor Jim got a hold of me, says, you better get some things right before they kick you out, you know. So I knew I had to get taken care of some things, right? But all of a sudden I get a phone call from the fire department, because I didn't know anything about CUPs and building permits. Man, we just rented a building and started having church. And all of a sudden, I get a call from the fire department. You're not having church in there, are you? I'm like, we're meeting, you know? And so here I am. I get this call, and I'm totally freaking out, man. I'm like having a hard time. I'm laying in bed, you know, and I don't feel like praying. I mean, I was laying there, and I remember Heather came up to me. And she says, what's the matter? I go, oh, man, they're going to throw us out. Oh, man, come on. How many know you can buy the ticket before the train ever shows up? You know, it's interest paid in advance on something you may never own. That's fear. Amen. And so I'm sitting there and I'm freaking out. I'm laying in bed. And she's like, you know, just believe God. Let's pray. I don't want to pray. Anybody ever felt like that? You know what? You know what, Pastor? I found out what it means to be groanings that cannot be uttered. It's that, eh. Yeah. God hears those prayers. Yeah. Anybody ever feel like praying like that? Yeah. I don't feel like praying today. Hey, I see myself on the screen. That's kind of neat. Rocky, I want that. Amen. You know, and it's like, yeah, I want to pray. I don't. She's like, come on, you got to believe God. And, you know, and your wife shows up and let's pray. You pray. I just say, am I the only one? Don't you feel normal? You're probably out there going, I'm normal, you know? So she's praying, and I'm just sitting there, amen, hallelujah. And, you know, and it all worked out. Everything was great. But, you know, I realized something in my own personal life, that I was mighty man of faith and power, but yet I was really a mighty man of paste and flour. Because when everything was going good, I had faith. How many, is it okay if I go down here? Nah, that's better. Because how many know that you can, when you've got money in the bank, it's easy to serve God. Come on, I better go back up here. When you got money in the bank, oh man, I know what that's all about. Hey, all the bills are paid, got a good job, everything's good. Come on now, you come into church, you walking in the front door, hallelujah, brother, you got good. Woo! God is good. Woo! Amen, brother, high five. Worship's coming. Oh, hallelujah. Rocky's up here. Woo, you know. I mean, we're just having a great time. God is so good. It's okay when everything's going good. We can trust God when everything's going good. But all of a sudden, everything changes. And we're walking back to church, and it's no more hallelujah. It's always, you know, jaw on the ground, knuckles right. Because we're believing God, everything's great when everything is going good. We have faith.
But when it's not going good, do we have faith? And I found out a long time ago, you know, I was a bipolar Christian. I was up one day, down the next, up one day, down. How many know I've been there? Amen. Hey, come on, man. I believe God doesn't want us to be like that. He wants us to be stable. Amen. He wants to have a faith that stays. See, we need a faith that'll get us through what we're going through. And God's going to test that faith, and He's going to push you on that faith, because untrusted faith, untested faith is untrusted faith. Let's talk about faith for a moment, if I may. This faith thing. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 23, the disciples are in a boat. And we kind of know the story, but I'm going to read it anyways. Now, when he got in a boat, the disciples followed him. Did you notice in this verse, I'll wait for you to get there. At Matthew chapter 8, 23, if you got it, say amen. Amen. If you haven't gotten it, say hold up. If you have one of these digital Bibles, would you raise your hand so I know that's not the Shekinah glory on you? It says, now when he got into a boat, his disciples followed him. Did you notice Jesus never told them where they were going? They just followed him. You know, sometimes God's not going to give you the answer. Did you know there are things that you don't need to pray about? God already told you, do it. Come on. You know, I used to be in children's church. You know, they come up to me, Pastor, you know, I've been praying about being in children's church. Why? Did God tell you to? Yeah, but I've been praying about it. Why? Aren't you glad Noah didn't pray about building the ark? God says, build the ark. Well, let me pray about it. That's for free. In my church, when I say it's for free, that means you can't hold it against me. It just kind of popped out, you know. All right. Now, when he got into a boat, his disciples followed him. And listen to what it says. And suddenly, a great tempest arose on the sea. Suddenly. It didn't say they rowed out into the water. They just got into the boat. I believed as soon as they got in that boat, they weren't that far from the shore. All of a sudden, it says right there. And suddenly, now he got into a boat and his disciples followed him. And suddenly, a great tempest arose on the sea so that the boat was covered with the waves. But he was asleep. Man, that's a fast sleeper. But they got into the boat and a tempest arose. And it didn't say they went that far out. Perhaps if I may allow myself to have a little bit of freedom to expound on this, it is perhaps that they never really got that far from the shore. Because see, when you decide to get in the boat with Jesus, a tempest might arise. Because God's going to test your staying power. Will you stay in the boat? Will you stay in the boat? How many have ever made a decision to do something for God? Come on. Freedom for our future. You make that big commitment. I'm going to do this. And all of a sudden you got in that boat and bam! A tempest arises. And all of a sudden, oh, I can't do it anymore. Whoa, wait a minute. You got in the boat. He's going to test your staying power. Are you going to stay faithful and obedient? Is your yay going to be yay? Or is it going to be nay, nay, no way? Then his disciples came and to him and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we are perishing. They haven't even gone that far. It's all right, I'm just expounding. Let me have my little bit of freedom here. But he said to them, why are you fearful, O you of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the sea, the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. So the men marveled, saying, who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him? Now, he says, O you of little faith. I have a little bit of a challenge with that verse. Because in Matthew chapter 17, 20, it says, "And Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, for surely I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible." We've heard that scripture. So I begin to kind of scratch my head and think, wait a minute. Whoa, hold on, Jesus. Hold up here. You said that if we have faith as a mustard seed, we can make a mountain move. But then you turn around and said, "Oh, you of little faith." Which one is it? Is it mustard seed faith or is it big faith? Because I get in the boat, all of a sudden I have some trouble, and you say, "Why are you so fearful, oh, you of little faith?" But wait, hold on, Jesus. You said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, I can make a mountain move. So, come on, man. You're going to have to make up your mind here. Is it big faith or little faith? Which one is it? Y'all wondering where I'm going to go with it, huh? Don't worry, I've done my homework. It's okay. The word mustard seed, he didn't say if you have faith as the size of a mustard seed. He said if you have faith as a mustard seed. You see, a mustard seed is a different type of seed. See, a mustard seed has the ability, you can pretty much plant it anywhere. And it has the ability to pull moisture out of the air and begin to sprout and grow. You can put it in the desert, you can put it down low, you can do it, put it anywhere. It will find a way to pull moisture. It's an enduring seed. And when Jesus said, "Oh, you of little faith," that word "little" in the Greek, if you study it out, he's not talking about size. The word "little" actually means short-lived. Short-lived faith. See, and that's where Martha was. Martha believed, but her belief wasn't enough to take her. See, let me take you there. How many know when we pray for something, we have faith to believe? Then we've got to walk that faith out. Do I have an enduring faith that'll take me, as Pastor Deborah says, from the amen to the hallelujah of my prayer life? Do I have enduring faith? You see, mustard seed faith is not the size of your faith. It's the longevity of your faith. Is your faith stable enough to take you from the amen to the hallelujah of your prayer life? So what Jesus is telling disciples, "Oh, you of little faith," he's like, "Oh, you of short-lived faith, come on. You couldn't go from here to there and believe with me. You couldn't walk far enough with me. Come on." And God's going to challenge our faith in these areas, because what he's going to do is he's going to push our faith. He's going to press on us. He's going to challenge your faith. You know, we hear this word in the churches a lot. You know, in the Bible it says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You know, I have a challenge for you on that one. Is that all right? I like to shake doctrinal foundation sometimes. It says, so faith comes by hearing the word. You know, when we look at that, we think, "Oh, if I hear the word, my faith will grow." Did you know that's not true? Because that faith in Romans chapter 10 is not talking about mountain-moving faith. If you study it correctly in Romans chapter 8 and 9, it's actually not talking about mountain-moving faith. It's talking about salvation faith. Because, right, that's all right, I'll read it for you so you'll believe me. It says in Romans chapter 10, verse 8, "But what shall they say? The word is near, in you, in your mouth, and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich and to all who call upon him. For whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe on him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? For it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah said, Lord, who has believed our report? So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. See that faith right here? That salvation faith comes by hearing. It comes. It doesn't grow. It comes. How do we know that? Because come on, man. Think about it. We come to church all the time. We know our Bible. We hear tons of messages. But we don't have enough faith to heal a headache sometimes. Come on. We have it up here, but not down here. Because, see, faith doesn't grow by just hearing the word. Faith grows by exercising your faith. Because I can have a bunch of Bible knowledge of faith, but if I don't exercise my faith, if I don't exercise it, it doesn't mean no good. It does me no good. You know, I got this trainer. I call him the devil. Because he makes me do the things I don't want to do. But you know what? He pushes me. Why do I have this trainer that helps me exercise? Because he's always pushing me to do more than I want to do so that I can go a little further. I'm tired. I don't want to do this. He goes, 10 more. 10? What are you talking about? I can only do 5. Come on, you can do 10 more. And I was thinking about this the other day. I decided to get into cycling. When I get into stuff, I go all the way, man. I don't mess around. I'm extreme on anything I do. So I got the whole outfit. I look professional. You look at me, you think, man, that guy's been riding for years. I've been riding for 2 weeks. I got the best bike and the whole outfit and everything, man. And so I was riding my bike, right? And I'm cycling. I'm about 5-10 miles into it. And if you're in Yucaipa, man, it's like all hills. I found out something. Oh, my goodness. But I've been riding for a few days and going about five miles. And I thought, okay, you know, it's going to get easier. It's going to get easier. It's going to come a time where, you know, riding this bike 5 miles, 10 miles, it's going to get easier. But as I'm riding and I'm thinking, all right, this is going to get easier. And it did get easier. I'd do 5 miles, no problem whatsoever. And then as I'm riding, I realize, wait a minute. That's the wrong attitude. Because you don't ever want to get to a place where you maintain or you're not growing anymore. It's kind of like go to the gym, you know, and you're lifting those weights. Everybody thinks the more I lift weights, the easier it's going to get. You don't want it to get easier. If it gets easier, you better put more weight on it or you're not growing. And it's the same thing. Sometimes our faith can be maintained. See, I'm comfortable with this. I have enough faith to stay comfortable. But God says, nah, the just will live by faith. I'm going to push you because I want your faith to be strong, enduring faith that you can go longer and stronger and hold on. Amen. See, we're not called to have maintenance faith. Huh? Come on, I've had maintenance faith before. You know? And I believe God wants us to go further, wants us to go higher. He wants us to stretch that faith. Because untested faith is untrusted faith. Untested faith is untrusted faith. I believe God is trying to challenge us in these areas. To stretch our faith. To feel the burn. Anybody ever do exercising? If you don't feel the burn, you're not growing. Like, oh, it's burning, I'll stop. That's not going to do nothing. You're going to tone a little, but not going to do anything. Oi, I stop now. It's hurting. You know, you got your bandana on.
Ooh, I'm done. You gotta burn, man. You gotta feel it. You know, sometimes what I will say is, if you don't feel the burn, that's not faith. You feel faith. You better feel the burn. I shared this story once. My wife and I'm going to end with this. I had this income tax refund. And I was so excited. Heather was even more excited because she was going to pay bills. I was like, uh-uh. Shoot. And it was a pretty good amount of money. It was like $1,200. And so I was like, yeah, right on. Get to buy something. She was like, we can pay bills. I said, what you talking about? So this church was coming, and God spoke to me, and he said, empty yourself out, and I will fill you up. I was like, what you talking about? He said, empty yourself out, and I'll fill you up. I said, you're not talking to me, are you? Anybody ever had arguments in church, you know, when it's offering time comes, God's telling you something, it's like, what? I'll give my maintenance faith. What? Come on now. So I heard God tell me, pushed it on me. Because no, devil's not going to tell you to give. You know that's God then. Come on now. So I go to Heather and I tell Heather, hey, you know, God spoke to me. What did he say? Because, you know, she knows when God speaks to me, I go crazy. You know, I just do it. Just do it. It's like Nike, just do it, you know? And so I went up to Heather and I said, God told me to put this in an offering. She's like, man, you better hear from God. I said, well, I didn't hear from the devil and I didn't hear from my flesh. Because my flesh is saying, no, keep it, spend it, buy something. You might need it for a rainy day. You're going to spend it. You're not going to keep it for a rainy day. And so she said, all right, we'll do it. So you go to church, right? The offering bucket comes by. And I wrote that check and I put it in the offering bucket. Now I wish I could tell you that I was like, you know, dum da da da, Mr. Faith and Power. But man, that offering bucket went by, I dropped it in there, and I was like, what am I doing? And I tell you what. That bucket went by, and I was like, all right, man, this is good. I got this, man, all right. Whew, whew, whew. I felt the burn that time. Felt it. Whew, whew. I go to work the next day. I found out they're laying everybody off. I'm like, shoot, I'm not getting laid off. I put $1,200 in the offering. My God is good. Guess who was the first one got the pink slip? Right here, man. I walked out, man. I found out there's a new ministry called the Boohoo Ministry. You know? I did. I lost my job. I didn't know what I was going to do. And so I go home. I'm just bummed out, arguing with God on the way home. Anybody ever done that? See, I got in the boat, and the tempest arose. See, I knew God was able to do something. I knew God would do something, but I had to have faith now. A now faith. He's going to test that faith because untested faith is untrusted faith. You know, James talks about faith that's tested. And so I start looking for a job. I can't find a job. Things aren't going well. And all of a sudden, I get a phone call, and this phone call was a company that I had put an application in a long time ago. They actually hired somebody else, and they didn't hire me. It was one of those jobs, the big high-end jobs, where they actually send you a letter and say you didn't get the job, you know? That's how nice they are. And so they called me, and they said, hey, is this Mr. Flores? I said, yeah. They said, well, you had put an application in the past. I said, yeah, you know, I thought you had hired somebody else. They said, yeah, but for some reason, the guy just up and quit on us. Want to go back to school or something. And I was like, really? What is a coincidence? And so they call me in for an interview. I walk in. And they give me the job, and I'm excited. And I ask them, how much am I going to get paid? And when they told me, I was like, oh my goodness. It was $1,200 more a month than my last job. I was like, dang it, man, I should have gave more. I'm ready. You know, there's going to be times in all of our life where God's going to challenge your faith, because the just will live by faith. It's not going to allow us to be comfortable. You jumped on in the boat when it came to freedom for our future. He's going to test that. Some of you have been tested in that. Backed off maybe a little bit. God says, come on. Come on. I'm going to push that faith. I'm not going to just let you have maintenance faith. I'll push you. Extreme faith produces extreme results. If you want to see God do something supernatural, something beyond yourself, something that presses a little more till you feel the burn. Oh, I tell you, God just wants to keep pushing you higher and further, and bless you and be a part of everything in your life. Whatever you're believing for, whatever you're thinking about, whatever you're going through, believing God, that my God is able to do all things exceedingly and abundantly above all that I could ask or think. See, we know it up here sometimes, but God says, you got to get it here. You can't just have a mental knowledge of it. See, faith is not a desire express. It's a confidence confessed. It's not just saying I like this to happen, or I'm believing. It's believing. It's pushing in. And I believe that God's going to take you into areas of your life where you're going to get in the boat, and he's going to take you to the other side, and you're going to be challenged in your faith. But I tell you, come on, 28 years I've been doing this. Listen, I have been a tither for 28 years. I have never not tithed, never not trusted God with my finances. And I declare to you in 28 years that I have not had a financial problem in my life. And most of the issues we go through is not because God's not faithful, is because we need wisdom. I need wisdom with my finances. Lord, give me wisdom so I can be wise in my spending. But I want to encourage you today. God's been pressing on you in areas of your life to believe him for the supernatural, to believe him to move in your life, to believe that God is able and God's going to press on you and push on you. Maybe right now you're in maintenance mode faith. You're kind of just there, you know, and God's been challenging you. Step out. Take that extra step. We are a result of our daily routine. If we want the result to change, we got to change what we do daily. We're just a result of what we do daily. If we want the result to change, we've got to change what we're doing daily. And trust God in these areas of our life. See, Martha believed in the miracles of the past. She believed in the miracles of the future. But she didn't trust God for now. I am able to do it now. And I believe God is teaching us something today about extreme faith. Amen? If you got something from Jesus today, why don't you give him a praise? Amen? Amen. Listen, they've already taken offering and done all that, but perhaps you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus. I want to give you that opportunity. Maybe you came tonight, someone invited you, and you're here in this wonderful church. and someone brought you or you just wandered in, you know, most people don't just wander into a church just to check it out. Usually because God brought you here, you needed something and you're trying to find an answer. There is an answer here. His name is Jesus. He is the way. He's the truth you're looking for. And he wants to touch your life. Perhaps you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus. Let me just share something with you. The Bible says that if you want to make heaven your home, you must be born again. You know, a lot of people think that, you know, I'm okay with God as long as I do good works, as long as I, you know, my good outweighs my bad, I'm okay with God. But I don't want to be okay with God. I want to know God, and I want God to know me. I don't just want to be okay with God. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says that if you want to make heaven your home, you must be born again. And what is born again? It's surrendering all of your heart and all of your life to Jesus. It's an all or nothing deal. It's not a little bit in, a little bit out, token prayer once in a while. Here's a good one. 911 Jesus. Then I forget about him once everything is okay. See, God loves you. He's not mad at you. He's mad about you. He loves you. Maybe today you've never received Jesus. I want to give you that opportunity. Or perhaps you're here today and you, at one time you gave your life to Jesus. And you were serving God, but you kind of backslid. You kind of got off track with God. Let me tell you something. Today, you can come back, and guess what? This is the cool thing. You're not starting over with God. You're just getting back on track with God. That's what's cool. I'm glad this prodigal son didn't have to start over with his father. You know, he had to start over in some areas of his life in regards to recouping some things he lost. But in the relationship with his father, he didn't start over. His father said, come on in, son. You're my son. God loves you so much. Here, I'm going to give you this opportunity. Listen, I'm not here to convince you to get saved. That's not my job. The Bible says no man comes unto Jesus except the Father is drawing him. So if the Father is speaking to you, you know, and there's a tugging in your heart saying, I need to get right with God. I need to get right with God. I'm going to give you that opportunity. I'm going to count to three. And when I count to three, I'm going to bang my hands together just like this, bang. When I bang my hands together just like this, bang, I'm going to ask you to lift your hand up and put it right back down. Well, Pastor, why should I do that? Because the Bible says that if you acknowledge me before man, I'll acknowledge you before my Father. If you deny me before man, I'll deny you before my Father. And I'm a man. I'll see you lift your hand up and put it right back down. Oh, it's a good thing. This is a good thing. I'm glad God gave me an opportunity to repent and give my life to him. Amen. It's good. It's good. Look at your neighbor and say, it's good. So come on now. I think it's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing in your life to give your life to Jesus today. Oh, what a time. What a time. What a time. Amen. So get ready to lift your hand up. This is a good thing. Amen. God loves you so much. On the count of three. One, you're running from God instead of two, God, I'm talking to you. Two, you're not sure you want to be sure, I'm talking to you. Three, just put your hand up and put it right back down. Anyone in this place? I see a hand over here. Anyone else? I see some hands over here. Come on. Anyone else? Don't rub your head. I'll count you. There's another hand over here. Another one. Come on. Don't let those kids raise their hands. It's all right. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Listen, this is what we want to do. We're going to all stand in just a moment. And when we do, I'm going to invite you to come stand right here with me. Because listen, taking a few steps for Jesus in a safe and friendly place is a good thing. Because when you leave, it's going to be hard out there. So we're going to stand together. I'm going to invite you to come and stand right here with me. And we're going to pray together. Is that all right? Come on, let's all stand together. You raise your hand. Would you come? I want to shake your hand. I want to say hello to you. I want to pray with you. Come.
Jesus,
come.
Come.
Come. You want to receive Jesus as your Savior.
Jesus,
come. They're coming. Come. Come. They're coming. Come. Come. Amen. Come.
I breathe. Jesus,
come.
I believe.
Hallelujah.
In you.
Come, they're coming. Come.
Jesus,
come.
I belong.
Oh, hallelujah. Come.
To you. You're the reason,
come.
That I live.
Oh, God has a wonderful life for you. All you gotta do is say yes.
Jesus,
all you gotta
I
do is say
believe.
Yes. All you have to do is say yes. Come.
Jesus,
come. All you have to do is say yes. Oh, yes. Come on, he's got some plans for you. Come, come. All you have to do is say yes. Oh, hallelujah. It's a good thing. This is good. This is good. It's celebration time. Oh, come, come. Amen. I'm so glad that you're up here. Listen, I want to tell you something. You know, a lot of times, you know, in the Bible, it says that there's great joy in the presence of the angels when one gives their life to Jesus. You know, a lot of times we think in our mind that the angels are rejoicing, but I like to see it like this. There's great joy in the presence of the angels. It's Jesus who's sitting in the presence of the angels. It's Jesus going right on. And all the angels are saying, oh, he's jumping. Let's jump too. You know? Amen. Come on. Listen, go ahead and bow your head and close your eyes. Now, I could lead your lips, but I cannot lead your heart. But the Bible says that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Christ rose from the dead, you shall be saved. So today I'm going to lead your lips, but you can only pray with your heart. So say this with all your heart. Everybody's going to say it with you. Maybe you didn't come down, but you should have. They're coming. They're still coming. It's okay. But maybe you should have come down, but you didn't. You can still pray this prayer. Amen. Because sir, there's some people, they're just like, I'm not going down there. It's okay. There'll be prayer teams up here after serving. Come, let them know you gave your life to Jesus. Amen. But you guys up here, amen. Thank you for coming. Come on, let's bow our heads. Say this with me with all your heart. Say, Jesus, come into my heart. Let's all say it together. Forgive me of all my sin. I believe you died on the cross. And you rose from the dead to give me a new life. And I accept you now as my Lord and Savior. I repent of all my sin and I turn towards you. In Jesus' name, I am a Christian. I am born again. Amen. Let's give Jesus a praise today. Amen. Listen, this is a good day for you. All brand new, clean. It's your birthday. Like Heather's birthday is your birthday. Your spirit. Amen. My birthday was January 7th, 1987. Amen. I have a birthday. I have two birthdays. Hallelujah. Because I was born and then I was born again. Amen. All right. So you're going to make a left-hand turn, if I can ask you, please. This is Pastor Joel, wonderful man of God. He's going to lead you into that room. Nothing weird is going to happen. I'm as weird as it gets because I am weird. But it's okay. I like me, so I'm okay with me. Okay? You're going to make a left-hand turn, follow Pastor Joel, let's give you some information. Come on, let's give Jesus a praise. Amen.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.